on this piece called Dresses with Catheter. So this is an excerpt from it. Just be, if you can, spatially aware as we move through the space, kind of adapt to us if we seem like we're going to be in your way, and also be spatially aware of the statues. And so Amy and I have been working together for a little over a year and a half, and we wanted to share some of our experiences with accessibility in this city.
And we want you to know that we will be around today. So if you have any questions or comments for us, please let us know.
Yeah, and without further ado, we're gonna be those people and talk about bathrooms.
So most people would think that this is an invasion of personal space, but when you have a disability, you don't really have the option of having a lot of personal space, and our boundaries are really set up so that it's an invasion of personal space if something is unnecessary, especially it's awkward, if strangers invade your personal space.
Another thing that I think about as awkward is just this concept that being self-conscious of your own bodily functions and your body noise is a learned behavior. And I remember in sixth grade being in a stall toilet, and there was someone in the stall next to me, and I remember not going because I didn't want the person next to me to hear, and I was really waiting for them to leave, and they didn't end up time, so I ended up leaving without even going to the restroom. And it's interesting how at this point in my life and how I feel at this current day and age, there's like a lot less shame in that department. And it's really interesting when you find a buddy in the stall next to you that's also equally unashamed. And I feel like there's like this bonding that happens over your body noise.
Speaking of noise, I've noticed that a lot of people that don't use words because of their disability, it's often seen as noise. And people tend to make decisions for us. And it's not to say that we don't need a lot of help, because a lot of us are kind of divas in the bathroom when it comes to our daily routines.
Yeah, I also think about times when I'm like my own self unaware diva, and where, you know, if I have enough time, I can straight up have the privilege to sit on the toilet for so long that my butt falls asleep.
I have that too. Sometimes I sit there so long that people forget about me, or I read a whole book. One time I won a contest for reading the most pages simply because I was in the bathroom so much.
Yeah, I think about too, what if we spent an entire day on the toilet? And also, what if people could get a window into that side of our private lives, that private, old, familiar space?
You know, I have to plan my entire day around accessible bathrooms. Will they be accessible enough? Where are they? When are they? You know, will I have to turn down things just because there isn't an accessible bathroom? I mean, it's 26 years after the ADA. Come on, people. We should have figured out power chairs by now. I mean, really? I have to go home to go to the bathroom. What am I, two? This is ridiculous.
Yeah, I think about, on a contrary, how often I casually will just talk to my friends, or will be in a situation where, you know, we're crunched for time, and I can so easily just be like, okay, will you hold on for 1 minute? I'm gonna run to the bathroom really quick. I'll be right back.
Speaking of friends, when I was in high school, they had this rule that I could only go to the bathroom once a day because they didn't want the liability of having one person helping me by themselves. And obviously, that didn't work very well, and people saw, and it was really embarrassing. So I had to have this whole big meeting just to have permission to go to the bathroom more than once a day. It was ridiculous.
I also have an embarrassing story where I was playing board game with my big buddy, and somehow I ended up peeing all over the board game. And I remember being really embarrassed and also thinking like, oh man, I really hope people don't talk about this in their own, you know, private spaces where I can't hear and congregate, and then, you know, end up like amplifying my embarrassment.
Speaking of congregating, people with disabilities, we don't really congregate in bathrooms because there is not enough space and it's such an ordeal, it's just not worth it. We really congregate in your elevators, which interestingly enough is not a gendered space.
Gender. It's interesting how in certain circumstances we are perhaps more comfortable surrounded by people of our own perceived gender, and there's other circumstances where we're more comfortable in a co-ed space.
Speaking of co-ed space, you know the bathroom bill is really damaging for people with disabilities, and it's really complicated.
You mean the bathroom bill isn't just about gender and privacy?
No, actually, it states in the bill that if you need help because you have a disability from a person of the opposite gender, that you can have that, but it doesn't explain how that works. And how you tell people what you need. And the other thing about the bill is it makes a bunch of crimes an automatic felony if they take place in the bathroom. And some of these crimes, like assault or voyeurism, might be the way that some behaviors because of your disabilities are interpreted, and they don't really tell you how to handle that situation.
I think about too, as I've been spending more and more time with Amy, just how much terminology and lingo there is that I'm learning about all the time. And so one term that is widely used is that when you need to go to the bathroom, you ask if you can be transferred. So there's this word transfer that I learned. It's basically like another equivalent of saying like, okay, I'm gonna go powder my nose. You know, it's like a coded way of explaining what you need without actually telling people what your business is.
So this word transfer, it can mean a lot of things if you have a disability. It's basically any way to move your body from one place to another, whether you need help or not. So you might transfer from chair to chair, or from chair to bed, or even to the pool, and of course, the bathroom.
Yeah. Ready? One, two, three, four. One, two, off. Back, phone off, get it out of the way, unbuckle, one, two, adjust, align, ready?
Ready.
One, two, three. Pause. The rest of the transfer would be happening now. Play. One, two, three. Make adjustments as needed. So, when I hear the word transfer, I cannot not think of Amy and our experiences. For example, I think of Amy when I hear people say things like, can we transfer the pasta to the to-go box? Can you help me transfer these files? Can we transfer this pattern onto this t-shirt? Will you help me transfer money into my checking account?
When I'm talking to my friends, most of them who have disabilities, they know what transfer means, so I don't have to explain it. But when I'm talking to my friends who don't have disabilities, I have to explain it. But sometimes I don't, because sometimes they really don't need to know what I'm doing.
Yeah, I'm learning new things every single day that I'm spending with Amy. There's all of this terminology and lingo, you know, and like all of these cool things that, you know, isn't a whole other language, especially acronyms. Alphabet soup.
So earlier, I went to this wedding and I had to have a catheter because I had a procedure and I really didn't know what I was doing at all. It was ridiculous. So of course, I'm wearing a dress because it's a wedding. So we have to use duct tape to duct tape the thing underneath my dress. And you know, people kept asking me why I wasn't just doing my regular transfer and why I left the wedding early. And my only kind of vague response was, I really don't know what I'm doing when it comes to dresses with catheter.
Well, that's because sometimes the dress is easier than the rest, and sometimes the pants are free. But whether it's an aesthetic or a mobile choice, I can cater to me.
So I had this friend who was living in a nursing home at the time, and he preferred to wear dresses, and the staff in the nursing home didn't really agree with that, so they would not dress him according to his preferences. So whenever we hung out, we would help him change because we wanted him to feel listened to.
Yeah, I'm learning more and more ways to be able to listen to Amy and sometimes her verbal communication and learning her other forms of communication and her needs, while also being aware of my own forms of communication and my own needs.
I think that sometimes people who are helping think it's easier just to do the faster thing or the simpler thing. And that's how unnecessary diapering and catheterization happens. But I really think we need to stop and pause and listen and make sure that everyone is heard.
Yeah, and even as Amy is often very clear and precise in communicating her needs, there are so many times where I will forget a section of a transfer like step or, you know, just forget things that we've discussed several times. For example, there's one time where I was transferring Amy to her bed and I took her shoes off before transferring her, and she needs her shoes to transfer. And so as I took her shoes off, she told me, "Hey Kelsey, I think I need my shoes in order to transfer." And I was like, "Oh yeah." But what I really said as I was thinking of a response is, "Well, you know, Amy, I only took your shoe off so that I could put it back on and Cinderella you." There was another circumstance where in the transfer, as we take and unbuckle all of these things and put things up in the right way and make sure her chair and her body is where it needs to be, we have to unbuckle the seatbelt before I reach in and lift her up. And in this certain circumstance, I did all of the steps except I forgot the seatbelt. And so I ran in to reach in to help with the next step, which I thought was the right one. And she was like, "Kelsey, I think you need to take off the seatbelt." And I was like, "Oh, but Amy, I just wanted to give you a hug." Okay.
So there's lots of muscle memory in this, and sometimes it varies day by day, but that gets incorporated into your muscle memory too. So muscle memory is really cool, and I like that part of where your brain interacts with physics.
Yeah. It's interesting how many moments, as prepared as you can be, as many times as you go through a specific transfer, there are always elements that invade your regimen. Like unpredictable physics. And so there are so many moments where we have to adjust and adapt to our needs and communicate and make sure that disaster does not happen.
Yeah, I'm no stranger to disaster. Feet getting stuck, broken ankles, just weird catches of things, but I'm kind of like the Avengers. I soldier on anyway.
Yeah. Well, we've been through many tough places before, and we've survived in history and now.
And we shall do it again!
You ready?
Ready.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3.
In everything that's light and gay.